Welcome back to the last session of the day. Now this is a quite an interesting session. It's going to be a quite an interesting session, unlike the morning session that focused primarily on technical issues. We are going to focus on larger political diplomatic issues in this session. When I said interesting and I refer to the morning one, it's not that morning session we're not interested. It was equally interesting. The only thing is that it was technical for a person like me, who used to be a sportsman and a political scientist. I had never to do with science and technology. This session is closer to my heart. One of the objectives, you know, yesterday we were talking about this BRICS initiative. One of the objectives of the government, you know, why is it it's investing in BRICS, and why is it it's investing in science and technology and BRICS Young Scientist Forum? As a political science person, my understanding is, of late, we try to look at what is referred as the soft power of India, and then how we can use our soft power as a diplomatic strategy vis-a-vis our neighboring countries and the larger world. And I'm sure from yoga to Bollywood, there are many things are being projected as India's soft power, soft image. So one of the things that we have been looking at is whether our science and technology, especially our science, can be our soft power vis-a-vis our neighboring countries and the rest of the world. So that's where you people come in. Scientists, whether you can play a role in our diplomacy, reaching out to a larger audience at the global level, or we trying to win the hearts and minds of regions and countries in rest of the world, you know. In a totally different context, you know, Plato said many years before, when he was looking at Greek city-state, the problems of the city-states. He was a philosopher, and then he saw kings bungling. So he came up with this brilliant one: unless kings turn to be philosophers and philosophers turn to be kings, the ills of the city-states will never cease. That's what he was telling. Maybe in this context, unless scientists turn to be diplomats, or diplomats turn to be scientists, I don't think that's going to happen, with all respect to Ambassador Raghavan here. Maybe how to see scientists as a kind of a diplomat, you know. So that's a larger plan that we had when we invited Ambassador Raghavan to speak to you on the subject of science and diplomacy. I have Professor Nagappa to chair this session. Sir, I hand over the floor to you.
Thank you, Subha. I think somehow Subha has contrived to have me present here both for the inaugural and the valedictory part of today's discussion. I don't know how we managed it. Okay. Yeah. All of you would have seen in very many sort of government-to-government interactions where the president and the prime minister of different countries meet. After all the other, this one you find a set of people exchanging files and shaking hands, and science cooperation, space cooperation, and various things are part of this one. It doesn't end with that. So there's much more in that, and especially of late, and I think you have two or three functionaries very clearly. Professor Ramamurthy, who was heading the DST, number of science cooperation, this one with other countries he had entered into. And Ambassador Raghavan, in his own way, has been pushing things. And as Subha mentioned, as a soft power from space, from aeronautics, on the land, on the sea, and things like that, there's a lot of diplomacy and science exchange happening. But instead of me dwelling on it, I think we should have really look at an expert who's going to talk to you about it. He's an expert in two or three ways, apart from being holding this one. One is, he has a PhD in electronics and communication engineering, after which he drifted into
PhD. Not PhD.
Okay, the master's degree from the India Institute of Science in electronics and communication engineering, after which he has drifted into the Foreign Service. I've been always teasing my close friend and colleague here, Professor Ramani, who did combustion engineering PhD and drifted into software coding, command, major level of programming, ending up as head of the computer and the information group in it. So I'm saying, you've been a traitor to the cause, but I can't say the same thing to Ambassador Raghavan. He's a blessing to the cause in many respects. He's held very key, important portfolios, including in PMO. He has looked after scientific departments like Department of Space. And he has held important portfolios in the ambassadorial area, this one is in England. And his last posting prior to retirement was in Russia. And he brings a large this one, and currently he's a convener of the National Security Advisory Board. So we really have in him a person who sort of not only learned science, talked science, and as a diplomat, looked at the positives of this. So I'd request Ambassador Raghavan to tell us about science and diplomacy. Over to you, Ambassador.
Thank you. Thank you very much, dear friends. It's very great to be with you. It's a somewhat unique gathering. You talk about BRICS. BRICS was always considered to be an intergovernmental body seeking to promote the global financial and economic architecture, etc., etc., etc. So from there to talk about a BRICS Young Scientist Forum is itself a leap of some kind of understanding. But since I'm speaking to a group of people who've been involved in BRICS, I just want to give you one broader picture. By the way, I have written an entire monograph on BRICS cooperation, which you will find. There is an Ananta Center website you'll find. You'll find this whole monograph. It's good to understand what is the background to BRICS, how was BRICS formed. As you know, it started off by a kind of a piece by a Goldman Sachs economist called Jim O'Neill, I think it was, who talked about these four countries, BRIC, as large countries with great economic power who will eventually by 2050, through their economic power, wield a lot of influence on the world. But then it was picked up politically. In fact, it was picked up first by the Russian President Vladimir Putin, who then talked about this grouping whose economic influence can also wield political influence and how they can come together. They talked about this. They talked about these four countries who had met at the foreign minister's level. They talked about the way in which they had common economic aspirations in the world in order to, as I said earlier, democratize the global financial and economic architecture, to try to get a stronger voting power in the IMF, in the World Bank, to try to see that the developing country interests, middle-level developing countries' interests are protected in the WTO. So all of this actually started the coalescing nature of BRICS. And then, of course, South Africa joined in 2011. That was a separate issue. Anyway, so once the BRICS leaders started gathering annually at a level of heads of government, heads of state, the ideas of other areas of cooperation also came in, other commonalities where they could see common benefit from cooperating in other areas, and that's how the science and technology cooperation came in. And out of that, of course, came this your structure of young scientists meeting at annual intervals in various BRICS capitals. I don't know how effective it has been. I'm going to be talking to you about how effective it has been and to get your ideas of if it has not been effective, why it has not been effective, are there any solutions, and so on. But before that, what I wanted to do also, since the subject that I've been asked to speak on is science and diplomacy, there is a much larger area. As you're not only BRICS young scientists, you're also scientists in India. You're working on different areas. You're working on, I think the larger issue of what is diplomacy in science. Professor Subhachandran said something about various areas. I'll come to that. You know, there are various categories of science diplomacy you can talk about. At one of these major levels, if you like, we have scientists and diplomats negotiating large international issues, like you talk about internet governance, you talk about cybersecurity, climate change is a scientific come diplomatic issue. Then you have this very specialized defense-related issues on disarmament, nuclear safety, even things like the MTCR, the Missile Technology Control Regime. You have discussions under the nuclear, the various other export control regimes. These are also scientific, international, political, diplomatic exercises with a very strong underpinning of science. And all these should be formed, should be considered as part of science diplomacy. And in all these, you see, science is important, but very often politics is more important. So you have a scientific underpinning, but eventually what deals get made are made on the basis of national interests of companies, of countries, as determined by the politicians of those countries, as determined sometimes by the economists of those countries. So science plays a very important role, but eventually takes a backseat to politics and economics. But it's very important for scientists to understand that, because they have to make sure that they've given the right level of input into these political and economic negotiations. So science diplomacy is part of this mix of science, politics, economics, and diplomacy, of course. But if you come down to a more basic level, most of you are not going to be participating in international disarmament negotiations or climate change negotiations or internet governance negotiations. All the same, there is a huge, large element of diplomacy which every scientist actually has the potential to be involved in. And I want to talk about these various areas. I have here actually two illustrations which I will come to later, but essentially, you know, a few years ago, India successfully put a spacecraft in Mars orbit. It was a huge technological achievement. It was something, we were one of the very few countries to do it. I'll come to that later as well. The question is, did we make proper diplomatic use of this major scientific feat? The other one is a more recent launch of an international solar alliance. Again, you know, it has been done with much fanfare. Over 120 countries who are in the so-called Sun Belt between the Tropic of Cancer and Capricorn decided to band together to form the solar alliance in order to maximize the production of solar energy. It is also part of our strategy against climate change. Again, this was a major diplomatic achievement, but the science is still to follow. So these are two elements which you keep in mind, and I'll come back to that later. Now, at a more basic level, I see that here you have scientists working in universities, you have engineers working in various research institutions, you also have teachers, but also I find, for the first time in such a group, I find that there are a few people from the private sector. You are scientists working in Reliance and Tata's and so on, as a couple of other places. And you might wonder how science diplomacy can be of use to you. What I want to be able to establish is that even for your businesses, even for the furtherance of the companies that you are in, science diplomacy can be very useful. I always start with this, actually, when I give a lecture, whether it is on foreign policy, whether it is on strategy or science and technology, because everything that we do in our country has to be pursued within the framework of the core national objectives of our country. We're all working in the same cause in our different spheres. So what are India's core national objectives? I don't think anybody needs to would argue with this with this listing, that economic growth, equitable development, elimination of poverty, raising living standards, this is the fundamental objective of our country. This is the fundamental objective of everybody working in any sphere of human endeavor in our country. And of course, we want to become a developed country in the shortest possible time. And you add a subtext to that, if you want to talk about India's global footprint, we want to become a great power in global politics as soon as we humanly can. Now, if you have a foreign policy, the foreign policy has to help, has to facilitate. Most of these objectives have to be achieved through internal effort. But the foreign policy has to create an environment of relationships that can facilitate it and that can enable it to move forward, sometimes without external interference. Again, ensuring of national security, territorial integrity, autonomy for social and economic policy. If you do not have that autonomy of policy, you then come under pressure. If you do not have safe boundaries, you come under pressure. If your neighborhood is not safe, you come under pressure. So these are elements which foreign policy should seek to guarantee through external relationship. But what I have circled is the one that actually is more relevant to the present company. We need to be able to create a network of relations that can maximize our access to capital, technology, markets, and resources. And here you see, whether you're a private company or a government institution, one or the other of these applies to you. We do need capital, we do need technology, we do need markets for our production, we do need natural resources, strategic resources, a whole lot of. So we need to conduct a policy that maximizes our access to that, and science and technology diplomacy is very much an element which can work towards this cause. And diplomacy, of course, diplomacy is just a means by which a country's representatives pursues these foreign policy objectives. So in that sense, US scientists are also diplomats, your science diplomats, wherever you go, whether you're going to sign a contract, whether you're going to negotiate technology transfer. You're basically doing one or the other of these to further our interests. So what are the primary objectives of our science and technology policy? Again, these are very obvious. We need to enhance our technical skills and our research capacities. And this of course goes regardless of which ministry you're working for. I mean, when I say science and technology, it means not only the Department of Science and Technology, it means the various other departments as well. You know, you have here people from DAE as well. You have people from Department of Space, DRDO. I think I'm not sure you have them here. But Human Resource Development, the various research laboratories which come under CSIR. Etc. We need to enhance our technical skills and research capabilities. I think, again, no question about that. If you look at the scale of the problem, it is also obvious. You know, the Ministry of Human Resource Development tells you that you have about 6,500 institutions in our country, science and engineering institutions that produce 1.5 million engineering graduates. But we need to stop and see what the reality is. How many of these engineers are actually employable in engineering tasks? I think a number of independent surveys gives you a very disappointing picture. Figures are about 25-30%. So you really need to enhance the capacities. You need to enhance teaching capacities. You need to enhance capacities so that the product of your engineering institutions, science and engineering institutions, enhanced. Research is also a problem. You know, again, if you look at the top universities in the world, how many Indian universities are among the top universities? You have, in this same compound, you have Indian Institute of Science, which has done very well in this country. I think one of you is from the IISc as well. You have some of the IITs, but beyond that, we really do not have the quality of research in our institutions. It requires considerable upgradation. You also need, that's very good, that doesn't work, but this works. Also, harnessing education and research to growth and development needs. You know, I saw some of the papers that you people presented earlier today, and that's precisely in this particular area. But more frequently, you find that there is a disconnect between the research that is being done and the application. You also find a disconnect between technologies that have been produced and technologies that are actually being commercialized. I talked about this with a couple of you people actually at T as well. We need to find better methods of harnessing education and research to growth and development needs. Of course, I'm not saying you shouldn't do pure research, but when there is applied research, that applied research has to be applied, actually. And this is, again, another challenge. Infusion of latest technologies. You know, there are technologies available out there. We are developing a number of technologies, but there are a number of technologies available out there which we need to get so that we adapt to our situation, we then upgrade. You essentially need to stop reinventing the wheel and enable leapfrogging. So where does diplomacy come in? One of the first and the fund, I would say the basic diplomatic purpose, foster links between universities and research institutions, in between those in India and those in foreign countries. You know, Indian students go abroad. They go abroad to mainly to UK, US, Canada, maybe Australia. But there's so many other places where they can go to, where there's a good quality. I'm talking about science and technology education, by the way, not other education. We need to be able to open the door to them until such time that we can raise the technical capacity of our own institutions to a level that can actually suit the requirement of our students. We need to be creating opportunities for them abroad. And of course, we need to be creating opportunities for them to come back and work. And many of the places, like you can go to Korea and Taiwan and maybe Czech Republic, these are places where you can go and get a degree where you won't be able to get a job, so you'll come back to work in our country. But essentially, it's the job of science diplomacy to make students more aware of the opportunities abroad. Similarly, internships, seminars, conferences, these are capacity building measures. You know, one of the things that people say about our IITs, they produce people with wonderful theoretical background, excellent mathematical skills, but somehow there is that spark which is required to make them into excellent researchers, that's missing. There are a number of countries where you have a research culture, where they actually value the technical, the theoretical inputs that you can bring in. So if we can arrange more, and there is demand in Europe. I served in many European countries where universities were willing to fund Indian technical students coming in for summer internships to help their research projects. We need to be able to create the linkages, and we need to be able to promote this. And then, of course, the Gyan, you are aware of, this is a new scheme, of no longer so new, Human Resource Development Ministry, which enables us to get to source faculty short-term, medium-term, long-term from abroad to increase capacity in our universities. These are all, they all may sound very trivial, but I think they can have, if multiplied, they can have a big impact. I want to give two examples of Russia and Ireland, both of which are countries where I've served in. In 2015, we launched an association of Indian and Russian, a network of Indian and Russian universities. IIT Bombay is the anchor on this side, and there is a university in Siberia which is on the Russian side. Enabling universities to talk to each other about what they're doing, where are the research possibilities, what are the people, what are the areas that they're looking for collaborations in. A capacity building measure. In the case of Ireland, I'll give you only one example. There is this Trinity College Dublin, which is actually among the top 50 universities in the world, which teamed up with the Thapar Institute of Engineering and Technology, and they are now trying to make Thapar Institute of Engineering and Technology into a top both research and education institution in engineering and technology. These are the kind of things that diplomacy can do at the base level in order to help capacity building in India. Catalyze research collaborations. Now this, when you talk about your BRICS Young Scientist Forum, this is also another way of doing exactly this. Trying to create awareness, trying to link institutions with each other, make people aware that there is a world out there from which there are possibilities. And here, I would like to say one thing about what both Professor Subha and Professor Nagappa said about soft power. We have to be a little careful about how we consider our S&T collaboration. Soft power is projection of your capacities abroad in such a way that you expand your influence. But I think we need to understand that there is a lot of things that we have to learn from outside. And we should not fall into this trap of thinking that we have something to give to others. We need to understand that there's a lot from outside that we can get. And here, my experience has been that even with some of the smallest countries that I've worked in, there are things that they can teach us. And we need to understand that. So research collaborations have to work with this basic fundamental understanding that we may be able to give something, but there is a lot that we also need to receive. We need to create, therefore, this awareness of where, what work is being done, what research is being done, what is it that we can gain from. Now, of course, the DST, DBT, and various other agencies fund a lot of these joint research projects. You see them on the websites of the DST. A lot of them are being taken up, but there are many, many more outside that are available. There are many which do not need to depend on government funding. And again, it is the job of our diplomats to find them, to put our scientists in touch with them, to generate financing also, to motivate foreign agencies to finance research projects. These are areas which science diplomacy has to work in. Now I come to something which is more in the line of what you people discussed earlier today. You know, there are a number of useful technologies out there in the world which have been developed at the lab level, but which have not been commercialized. They have not been commercialized for a variety of reasons. That they have been developed in countries where the development applications are not so strong. Maybe they have they don't have economies of scale. They are developed countries which established patterns which they do not need to want to change. But they have tremendous developmental applications for countries like India. Now, there are a few examples which during my diplomatic career I've come across. This is something, anaerobic digestion of municipal solid waste is something I'm sure you've all come across in different contexts. It's something that is working wonderfully well in the US, it's working wonderfully well in Europe,